Welcome to worship. Life is good. God is great. Jesus is wonderful. Heaven is waiting. The choir is going to invite us to let's have church.
Thank you. get together. Let's have church.
I've told you before, every time I stand in this pulpit, before me I have the words, "My heart is fixed on Jesus. No other hope have I. I could not live without him, and without him dare not die." And the scripture verse, "Looking unto Jesus, our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God." As we come to pray this morning, I wish you'd take your copy of the bulletin that was given to you when you entered the auditorium this morning, and just turn your eyes toward the prayer list that appears in the bulletin. And if you will, please, remember in prayer all of those whose names are printed on the prayer list. And on the back of the bulletin is the request to pray for the people of Ukraine, and for the president, bold and courageous as he is, Zelensky of Ukraine. Those people we have just about forgotten because this war has gone on for several months, but they are valiantly fighting for their freedom, their independence, for democracy, and they are being mercilessly slaughtered as they do so. Pray for the people of Ukraine and for the leaders of our nation that will know what to do in response to that international crisis. Our Heavenly Father, in the precious name of Jesus, we come to worship you today because you are God. You have made us, not we ourselves. You are our God, we're your people, the sheep of your pasture. We enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise. We're thankful unto you and we bless your name. Today, our Father, we ask that you will forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And help us to remember your word that says, if we do not forgive others, we cannot expect forgiveness from you. We cannot have fellowship with you if we refuse to have fellowship with one another. And so, Lord, I pray that you will cleanse us, that you'll restore us to a walk with you if we have strayed away, and so many of us have. Teach us to walk in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. We thank you for saving us through the broken body and shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for the precious promise of your word that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We claim that cleansing today as we confess the fact of our sins and name them individually in our minds and hearts. Thank you for your multitudinous blessings toward us. They are without number, as the sands of the sea and as the stars of the heavens are your blessings toward us. We love you, Lord, because you first loved us. We love you not because of what you've given us, but we love you because of what you have made us by sending your Son into the world, virgin-born, living a life of sinless perfection and dying in ignominy and agony upon the cross of Calvary, being raised the third day in order that we might be saved and justified. Yes. Oh Lord, we bless your name for eternal life. Thank you for what you have made us. And now, Lord, today we pray for the requests that are on our hearts. We pray today for those who have COVID. We pray for those who've been exposed to COVID and are quarantining because of it. We pray for those who are recovering from COVID. We pray, Lord, that you will spare us from the curse of the illness that we've called by the name COVID during this pandemic. And we pray, Lord, today that you'll remove this pandemic from our nation and from our world. We lift up to you in prayer today, Ukraine, the president, the people of Ukraine, that you will spare them and give them courage to defend freedom, democracy. And so many people in Ukraine are Christians. I pray, Lord, that you'll help them to defend the cause of religious freedom in that country. I pray for our president who is ill, that you will restore him to health. I pray that you will give him wisdom, and to the members of the House and Senate as well, and the members of the President's Cabinet and other national leaders to know how we are to respond to the Ukrainian crisis. We pray for those in authority over us nationally and in the state and in local government, that all may be guided by your omnipotent hand and may think the thoughts of your omniscient and all-wise mind. We pray today for those on our prayer list particularly. We pray for Deacon W.T. Marrow and his wife Nadine. Lord, will you minister healing to him and make it possible for him to be back in church with us very soon. I ask, Lord, that you'll give her the strength, the encouragement, the peace, the wisdom that she needs to care for him. I pray the same for Brother George Beatty and his wife, that you shall lay your good hand of blessing upon them. Give healing to Brother George, wisdom and strength, to Sister Millie, that they may know the recovery and good health that you have purposed and planned to give them. We pray for all those on our prayer list this morning. We're holding that list in our hands and we're holding those people in our hearts. Will you, great God in heaven, move and work in the life of each and of all to accomplish your perfect will and purpose. Today, our Lord, we pray that you shall bless us in this service, that it may be all that you've intended that it should be, and that we, through our hour of worship, may be strengthened, may be encouraged, may be convicted and challenged, and most of all, Lord, changed by your word and by your spirit. Today, our Father, we lift up to you our anniversary celebration next Sunday. And I pray you'll put it in the hearts of all our people to want to come. Speak to our deacons, members of various teams and Sunday school classes, church leaders, church members, and friends of this fellowship. Bring us all together next Sunday to celebrate 67 years of ministry in this city. Thank you, Lord, that last Sunday was the official birthday of our church, July 17. And thank you that next Sunday will be our great day of celebration and that we shall begin our 50th year together as pastor and people. Guide us by your Spirit. Counsel us by your word, with your eye forever upon us, that we may abide in the center of your will. I pray that all that is done in this place today, next Sunday, and beyond shall be in keeping with your will and shall be energized by the power of your Spirit and shall be to the glory of the name of Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Will you stand as we sing hymn number 350, The Church's One Foundation, hymn 350. It is wonderful to be able to welcome you on this Sunday morning. Thank you for being here. If you're a guest, I'd like for you, at the close of the service, to drop by the Friendship Desk in the main foyer. One of our ladies, Beverly Law, will meet you there, share with you some information about our church, welcome you to our midst today, and give you a gift. Just our way of saying thank you for being part of this service on this Sunday morning. Thank you so much for coming. And to those who are joining us online, some are with us right now at 11 o'clock on July the 24th. Others will be joining us subsequently. Later in the day, later in the week, we welcome you one and all. Thank you for being part of our viewing congregation. And I'd like to invite you, if you're watching online, to come to see us here at your earliest opportunity. It would be a privilege to have you come and celebrate our church's 67th birthday with us next Sunday at 10:30 in the morning. Please come to see us. Let's welcome one another and welcome our online guests with a warm round of applause. Now, with regard to next Sunday, let me tell you that in the foyer, on a table in the foyer, I'm going to look up to the balcony and ask Brother Tommy, do we still have some of these cards on the table, these invitation cards? You go by today. This will be your final opportunity to pick up some invitation cards and use them to invite and encourage friends, family members, business acquaintances, and others to come with you next Sunday to our anniversary celebration at 10:30 o'clock in the morning. Remember next Sunday. Remember online participants. Remember people in the pew. Remember church members who are watching from home. Next Sunday, our service begins at 10:30 in the morning. Sunday school will be at 9:45. We'll end at 10:15. An abbreviated Sunday school, and then our worship service at 10:30 in the morning. Pick up some of these cards. All of the pertinent information is on them, and hand them out to people all week. I have sent out dozens of these cards to my friends and acquaintances and members of our church as well. Pick these up and use this many of them as you prayerfully can to invite people to come to church with us next Sunday. And I also want to remind you that in the pew, there are love offering envelopes like the ones that I'm holding in my hand. This is a love offering for Dr. Gerald Harris, who will be our preacher next Sunday. Dr. Harris has served as pastor of some of the largest churches in the Southern Baptist Convention. He is a published author, having written several books, including a history of the Georgia Baptist Convention, big, thick book that I have in my library and that I've read, and commend to you if you'd like to know about the work of the Lord amongst Georgia Baptists, and also editor of the Christian Index for almost two decades, and now in semi-retirement as an itinerant preacher, he's in demand all over the country as a preacher of the gospel with a burning, fiery message to share with us. I thank God, and I'll express a gratitude to him when I see him, for including us on his schedule this year. And I want you to join me. My check is going to go in one of these envelopes, and it'll go in this week to be included in the gift that we'll give to him next Sunday. So you take one of these envelopes and use it today, or take it with you and prepare it for next Sunday to put in the offering plate so that we can give a worthy love offering to Dr. Gerald Harris. Today, we are so happy to have Layla Fletcher coming to sing to us. Kirk Rohn was scheduled to be our soloist, but had a family emergency that took him out of town. And I'll tell you, I'm smitten with joy to hear Layla Fletcher sing on this Sunday morning. She and I speak regularly. She is a source of encouragement to me. And on the way to church this morning, Brother LB and I were talking about her sainted husband, my associate for all those many years, Reverend Chuck Fletcher, Charles Henry Chuck Fletcher, who's looking down on us from heaven this morning. God bless you, Layla, as you sing to us.
I'll trust the cross where Jesus died. It is my hope. It is my guide. He paid the debt. My sins are gone. I'll trust the cross to get me home. Some men place their confidence in all of their good deeds. I have no confidence in mine, for I'm convinced that all my works could never satisfy the debt of sin created by my life. So I am trusting Jesus. I'm standing on his word. He said that when he died for me. Oh, the blood he shed that day is still the only way to have forgiveness for eternity. I'll trust the cross where Jesus died. It is my hope. It is my guide. He paid the debt. My sins are gone. I'll trust the cross to get me home. Religion made by man is sure to fail. It's only through the blood of Christ we can prevail. I'll trust the cross where Jesus died. It is my hope. My guide. My sins are gone. My sins are gone. I'll trust the cross to get me home. He paid the debt. My sins are gone. I'll trust the cross. I know the cross will get me home. He paid the debt. My sins are gone. I'll trust the cross to get me home.
Hallelujah. Let's stand and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We're going to trust him to get us home. Hallelujah. It's through that blood that He shed on the cross for our sins. It is for His resurrection that we live also. Please stand and take your hymnals. Turn to page 7 and let us continue with our praise and worship. Joyful, joyful, we adore Thee.
Joyful, joyful, we adore Thee, God of glory, God of love. Hearts unfolded, life perfectly open to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, dry the dark of towns away. Giver,
righteous Father, we come at this time to give You praise, honor, and glory, to worship Your name because You are the great God Almighty, the maker, the creator of everything and all things. We ask at this time, Father, that You would keep us in this place, holy and righteous unto Your name, that You would bless the offerings that is being taken today, and that You would use it, Father, according to Your will. And Father, we thank You for the givers, and we thank You for those who desired to give and did not have it. We ask Your blessings upon them, and we thank You, Father, for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
bless you. You may be seated.
Thank you, choir. One of the things that we can always anticipate here is that we'll have beautiful music. Amen. Enthusiastic participation by the congregation in the congregational hymns, and always marvelous presentations by the choir. Thank you for your preparation and for your presentation of gospel truth. And thank you, Layla, for that marvelous solo. That was absolutely wonderful. And to you and Cheryl Brown for the wonderful offertory this morning, Like a River Glorious. One of the most beautiful arrangements I've ever heard and so well played. As I've told you before, the offertories around here are so moving to me until if I were a multi-trillionaire, I'd herniate the ushers with the size of the offering that I would give that they'd have to carry to the place where our offering is placed. I've come to you this morning with a challenge. Go on believing. The 14th chapter of the Gospel according to John. We're going through, as you know, the Gospel of John right now. We have proceeded through the months and the years, actually, from John 1 now to John 14. We were studying the Gospel of John before the pandemic struck. And then during the time, the months that we were meeting in the parking lot, it didn't seem that we could effectively do an expository study of this book, so we departed from it. But when we did, my friend L.B. Murphy said to me, "When we get back in the auditorium, will you come back to the Gospel of John?" And as soon as possible, we came back to the Gospel of John. And here we are in chapter 14, verses 1 through 14. Go on believing. Amen. "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas saith unto him, "Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way?" Jesus saith unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth ye know him and have seen him." Philip saith unto him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it sufficeth us." Jesus saith unto him, "Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak unto you, I speak not of myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the works. Believe me, that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very works' sake." That is, if you can't believe on me because of who I am and who I say I am, then believe because of the mighty miracles that I've done. "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it." There is a close connection between chapter 13 and chapter 14. Between the events of chapter 13 and the promises of chapter 14. In chapter 13, you'll notice that the disciples had been rebuked by their lack of humility. Jesus did what all of them had failed to do for each other, and that was wash their feet upon their arrival for the Last Supper. Also in chapter 13, they were told that Christ would soon leave them. They were also told that the most respected and trusted member of their group, of the disciples, a man named Judas Iscariot would betray his master, and in doing so, betray them and the master's cause. In that chapter, Peter had been rebuked for not being a man of his word and for his forthcoming threefold denial of Jesus Christ before the rooster would crow in the morning. No wonder they were troubled. To offset the depression produced by this startling revelation, Christ brought a message of hope and encouragement. Jesus says, go on believing. Now I want you to skip down to verses 10 and 11 and look at those. I want you to look at the word believe in verses 10 and 11. The tense of believe in verse 10 and the tense of believe in verse 11 is go on believing. In other words, let your faith continue regardless of what happens. Amen. Jess Moody, the former distinguished pastor of the First Baptist Church in Van Nuys, California, and before that, pastor of the First Baptist Church in Palm Beach, Florida, West Palm Beach, Florida, said in one of his books, if your faith fizzles before the finish, it was faulty from the first. And I'll tell you, that's exactly what Jesus cautioned against when he said, go on believing regardless. Go on believing. Let faith continue to grow. Let faith continue to exist. Let faith continue to thrive no matter what happens. Well, what is it that Jesus is saying in those words, go on believing? Well, I have found in these 14 verses that Jesus is saying four things. Number one, Jesus is saying, go on believing in an incomparable person. Look at verse 1. Look at it in your Bible. And let me give you a little different translation of it. You trust God, don't you? Trust me. You're trusting God. Now trust in me. And if you do, you will not let yourselves be distressed. Trusting Jesus is a non-negotiable part of the Christian life. Some believe intellectually in Jesus, in the fact of Jesus, but they do not have saving faith in Jesus. That is, they view Jesus as a historical figure. Yes, they believe that Jesus was born and that some said he was born of a virgin. Yes, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. History and theology touch on that point. Jesus was born in Bethlehem. He lived for 33 years and 6 months, and he died on a hill outside the city walls of Jerusalem called Golgotha, the place of the skull, Calvary. And he was buried in the borrowed tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. And for the historically minded person, it ends there. But for the spiritually minded person, it continues to the third day beyond his crucifixion and burial, when he arose triumphant over death, hell, and the grave. Trusting Jesus, that is all. Amen. Some believe intellectually, some believe spiritually. Now I want to give you a reason for believing spiritually. Trusting not just in the fact of Jesus, but trusting through faith on Jesus. Let me tell you first that Jesus is chosen. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Another translation of that same passage says this, Acts 4:11 and 12, "For Jesus the Messiah is the one referred to in the scriptures when they speak of a stone discarded by the builders, which became the capstone of the arch. There is salvation in no one else. Under heaven there is no other name for men to call upon to save them." Matthew 12, verses 17 and following, talk about Jesus being the chosen of God, "that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, Behold my servant, whom I have chosen, my beloved, in whom my soul is well pleased." You remember at Jesus' baptism, God's voice shook the heavens when he said, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. I will put my spirit upon him, and he shall show judgment to the nations, to the Gentiles. He will judge the nations. He shall not strive nor cry, neither shall any man hear his voice in the street. He does not raise his voice in anger. A bruised reed does not crush the weak. And smoking flax shall he not quench." He will not quench the smallest hope. "Till he send forth judgment unto victory." Listen, Jesus is victor. You know that passage in 1 Corinthians 15:58. "Thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Could with equal accuracy be translated, "We have the victory, thank God. And in his name shall the Gentiles trust. His name shall be the hope of the whole world, of all the world." Jesus is chosen. Have you chosen him to be your Savior? Have you called upon his name? Have you trusted him? Have you invited him into your heart? Jesus is also changeless. Hebrews 13:8 says of Jesus, "Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever." He is what he has always been, and he always will be what he is and what he's always been. There is no hint, there is no shadow of turning in Jesus. Amen. Jesus is also comforting. Verse 1, Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled." Don't be distressed in heart. One translation says, don't let this throw you. Jesus is comforting. And he spoke words of comfort, much like those that Paul talked about in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 and following. Turn to it in your Bible and mark it. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 3, "Blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort, who comforteth us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them." We're comforted so that we can be comforters to them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, all who live godly in Christ Jesus will suffer persecution. So our consolation, our comfort, our encouragement abounds by Jesus. Jesus comforts us. There is not a storm so severe, not a night so dark, not a trouble so wearisome, not a burden so heavy, but what Jesus can comfort you. He's changeless. He's comforting. And I want to tell you also, Jesus is competent. You can trust him. Amen. He said, "You believe in God." Now, remember, he wasn't rebuking the Jews for their faith in God. Rather, he was commending them. And he said, you have believed in God. Believe also in me. The Apostle Paul echoed that theme in Colossians 3:11 when he said, there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all. Another translation says, in this new life, one's nationality or race or education or social position is unimportant. Such things mean nothing. Whether a person has Christ is all that matters. And he, Jesus, is equally available to all. Jesus is competent. He is all sufficient. You can trust Jesus. I have an admission to make. You can't always trust me. If you say to me after a service, pray for so-and-so, usually I'll take time to pray with you right then because you can't trust me to remember it forever. You might say, come by my house to talk with me. Well, you'll need to call and remind me or else watch me write it down. I might forget it, but I want you to know Jesus forever intercedes. Jesus is always there. You can go on believing in an incomparable person. Now, I said there were four things. Here's the second. Jesus is saying, go on believing in an indescribable place. Verses 2 through 4, I believe, merit reading again. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself. Get this, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know, and the way, you know. The poet wrote, my knowledge of that life is small. The eye of faith is dim. But 'tis enough that Christ knows all. And I shall be with him. As we contemplate that place, we need to see the following about it. First, the preparation is guaranteed. Verses 2 and 3 from another translation. There are many homes up there where my Father lives, and I'm going to prepare them for your coming. When everything is ready, then I will come and get you so that you can always be with me where I am. If this weren't so, I would tell you plainly, there's plenty of room for you in my Father's home. If it were not so, would I have told you that I'm on my way to get a room, a mansion, ready for you? I'm on my way to get your room, your mansion, ready. Amen. The preparation is guaranteed. You'll notice also the promise is given. Verse 3, I'll come back and get you. I will come back and get you. The Apostle Paul caught hold of that. And to the believers at Thessalonica, in 1 Thessalonians 4:13 through 18, he said, I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, those who died, that you sorrow not even as others which have no hope. If you don't have Jesus, you have unspeakable, unbearable sorrow. But if you have Jesus, your sorrow is as one who has hope that transcends this life and transfixes itself on eternity and the promise of being with Jesus and with loved ones there. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that's our highest authority, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not precede them which are asleep. Amen. We'll all go together. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trump of God. Yeah. You remember Revelation says, when John sees those revelations, messages to the seven churches, and then he says, I saw the heaven opened, and I heard a voice, a voice like as of a trumpet saying, come up hither. He saw Jesus calling the church out of this world. Those who have died, their bodies to rejoin their spirits, and those who are alive, we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and together we shall rise to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another, cheer one another up, encourage one another with these words. There are two avenues to heaven. One is death, and the other is the second coming of Christ, both of which are mentioned in Hebrews chapter 9, verses 27 and 28. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, that's the avenue of death, but after this, the judgment, our inevitable, inescapable accountability. So Christ was once offered to bear the sins of many, the vicarious substitute who died in our place upon Calvary. And it's implied that he arose and ascended back on high. And then it says, and unto them that look for him shall he appear the second time without sin unto salvation. Now that doesn't mean that he sinned one time because he never sinned, could not sin, for he was God. But he shall appear separate and apart from the question of sin that was settled once and for all at Calvary. Yeah. Unto the redemption, the resurrection of our bodies, unto our eternal salvation, going home to live with him in heaven. And when we speak of heaven, Jesus says the permanence is granted. Verse 3, so you can live where I live. The glory of that place is the personal presence of Jesus. You know, some people get hung up on gates of pearl, and that's fascinating. Foundations interlaced with precious stones, a street of gold. I want to tell you the most fascinating thing about heaven is the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star, Jesus, the Son of God. He's going to be there. And where Jesus is heaven, no matter what it looks like. Heaven is described as a kingdom. 2 Peter 1:11, so an entrance shall be ministered unto you abundantly, that is when we die, into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Heaven is called an inheritance. 1 Peter 1:4, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. Isn't that wonderful? We have an inheritance that's undefiled. Nothing can corrupt it. That doesn't diminish in value. That is reserved in heaven for us. No one can take it from us. Heaven is an inheritance. Heaven is a country. Hebrews 11:6. But now they, believers in Christ, desire a better country, that is, an heavenly. Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. And that leads me to say heaven is a city. Hebrews 11:16, he hath prepared for them a city. Hebrews 13:14 says, here we have no continuing city. All of our cities are in the process of deterioration. There was a time in this town when the neighborhood in which we're located was one of the most fashionable neighborhoods in the city. It's not so fashionable anymore. When I came to Columbus, the only apartment complex, no, the best apartment complex in Columbus was located on North Oakley Drive, and there were no apartments that I knew of on the north side of the city. But now that apartment complex has diminished in value and in quality of lodging, and the nicest apartments are farther and farther and farther north. We have no continuing city. It's getting away from us. But we seek one to come. Heaven is a home. Verse 2, there are many homes up there where my Father lives. And I'm going to prepare one of them for your coming. When I moved to Jacksonville to attend Lutherized Seminary, it was the first time that I had ever been away from home permanently. When I was at Howard College, now Samford University, I traveled back and forth because I pastored a church in southeast Alabama and stayed at home on weekends. But then when I went to seminary, Lutherized Seminary in Jacksonville, I was living away from home for the first time. And one afternoon, I'd been to seminary in the morning and went to the church and what we called in those days the church field, the community around the church. And I'd worked in my study for a while and had been out knocking on some doors for a while. And I started to my little apartment over in Springfield, and I felt so lonely, so alone. And I thought, Lord, why have you brought me here to spend my life alone? And WAYR, Way Radio, was signing off because the sun was setting, and they came on at sunrise and went off at sunset. And every day when they went off the air, they had someone sing a song. Who could ever mind the journey when the road leads home? You know, it really doesn't matter what happens betwixt and between here and there. We're going home. Before the days of air conditioning, I drove in a car that was un-air conditioned, and there were bugs and flies and gnats that came in and swarmed around me. But if I was headed home, nothing mattered, because I was going home. And I just want to tell you, physical limitations, mental anxiety, relational disruptions mean nothing, because it's just a short distance from here to there. Who could ever mind the journey when the road leads home? Go on believing in an indescribable place. I said there were four things. Here's the third. Go on believing in an imperative plan. Verses 4 through 6. You know where I'm going and how to get there. No, we don't, Thomas said. We haven't any idea where you're going or how can we know the way? Jesus told him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can get to the Father except by means of me. Jesus answers the way question with another I am statement that he made so often. And here he says, I am the way. Christ is the only way to heaven. John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Jesus said, I am the truth. Christ is the embodiment of all truth. In John 8:32, you remember from our studies, Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus is the living Word. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and I, the truth, shall make you free. Jesus said, I am the life. John 1:4, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. John 3:16, you know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that anyone who believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Merrill C. Tinney, who wrote the book, John, the Gospel of Belief, says, without the way, there is no going. Without the truth, there is no knowing. Without the life, there is no living. Go on believing in an imperative plan. There is one way to heaven, and his name is Jesus. Amen. Fourth, finally, go on believing in an inviting portrait. Well, I think I'm going to add a fifth thing, actually. Go on believing in an inviting portrait, verses 7 through 11. Look at those, if you will, please. And you'll discover, beginning in verse 7, that Christ is the revelation of the Father. Verse 7, if you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him. You've seen him. That is, in me, I am God incarnate in human flesh. John 1, 14 and 18. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. That's Jesus. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. No man hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. 1 Timothy 3:16, God was manifest in the flesh. Verses 8 and 9, Philip said, show us the Father and we'll be satisfied. Jesus replied, don't you even yet know who I am, Philip? Even after all this time I've been with you, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. So why are you asking me to see him? Philip was asking for a theophany, like Moses saw in Exodus chapter 33. Why don't you turn back to it in your Bible? I have it marked in mine, but you can turn to it easily in the Old Testament. And if you will, note verses 18 and following. Exodus 33, verses 18 and following. Before that, God had said to Moses, my presence shall go with thee, I will give thee rest. And he said unto him, if thy presence go not with me, carry us not up thence. Verse 17, the Lord said to Moses, I will do this thing that thou hast spoken, what you've asked, for thou hast found grace in my sight, and I know thee by name. Moses said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. And the Lord said in verse 20, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said to Moses, behold, there's a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. I think that symbolized the Lord Jesus personally. And it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in a cleft of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away mine hand, and thou shalt see just the back of me. My face shall not be seen. That's what Philip was asking for. Show us the Father, and we'll be satisfied. And Jesus said, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. Christ is the revelation of the Father. Christ is the reasoning of the Father. Jesus reasons with them in verse 10. How can you ask, where is the Father? Don't you believe that I'm in the Father and the Father's in me? The words that I speak unto you are not mere words. I don't just make them up on my own. The Father who resides in me crafts each word into a divine act. And you remember perhaps Isaiah 1, verses 18 and following, that begin with the words, come. Come now. Let us reason together. Let's talk this over. And then you remember God said, though your sins be as scarlet, though they be the worst possible sins, I'll make them as pure as the fresh driven snow. Jesus reasons with them of the Father. And in verse 11, Jesus gives us the results of the Father. If you can't believe on me because of what I say, because of what you've heard from me, believe because of the mighty miracles you have seen me do. Go on believing in an inviting portrait of God that's seen in Jesus Christ. And may I add this fifth thing. Go on believing in an invincible power. Verses 10 or verses 11 through 14. Believe what you see, these miraculous works. The person who trusts me will not only do what I'm doing, but will do even greater things, because I'm on my way to the Father and I'm giving you the same work to do that I've been doing, and I will do it. You remember Paul said, it is God that worketh in you both the will to give you the desire and to do, to give you the power to do what pleases Him. I will do it. That is how the Father will be seen. For who He is in the Son, I mean it. Whatever you request in my name, I will do. I want you to look in verse 12 at the accomplishments of power. Jesus said, in solemn truth, I tell you, anyone believing in me shall do the same works. The word in the Greek New Testament is miracles. I have done, and even greater ones, because I'm going to be with the Father. What a promise that is. I said, what a promise that is. The works of Christ were limited to a small geographical area and to a specific people. The disciples' works then, and our works now, will be, would be, shall be forever worldwide in their reach and will affect all people. In that way, what we shall do is greater. What the disciples did was greater. What you do in Jesus' name is greater because it encompasses the globe. How? Zechariah 4:6, not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. Amen. The accomplishments of power. Jesus said, you'll do the same thing I do. Doesn't that just light your shuck?
Amen.
Jesus said, you'll go on doing what I've been doing before you, and it'll be even greater because it will touch everyone. Well, how do you gain access to that power? Jesus gives it in verses 13 and 14. You can ask the Father for anything using my name, and I will do it. For this will bring praise to the Father. This will glorify the Father because of what I, the Son, will do for you. Yes, ask anything using my name, and I will do it. You notice in that verse the connection, the relationship of prayer to greater works. If you don't learn to pray, you'll never be able to work effectively. Acts 1:14, they continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. Acts 2:24, they continued steadfastly in prayers. Acts 3:1, Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer. Acts 4:31, when they had prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness. Effective prayer is, according to Jesus, in my name. This means that our praying must be in agreement with the desires of Jesus. You just can't be a name it and claim it person. You have to pray in keeping with the desires of Christ. The result of this kind of prayer is the glorification of the Father, not self-glorification. Psalm 1, verse 2 says of the godly man, his delight is in the law of the Lord. Amen. Psalm 37, verse 4 says, delight thyself also in the Lord. That is, be delighted about the things that delight God, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. In Galatians 1, the Apostle Paul talks about his life, how he had been Saul of Tarsus, a persecutor of the church, and he had met Jesus on the Damascus Road. He had been confronted. He had been convicted. He had been changed and challenged. And now the one who persecuted the church is preaching the message of the church. And in Galatians 1, verse 24, he says, they glorified God in me, They saw me, they heard me, and they gave glory to God. Do people who see you and hear you praise God? Give Him glory for what they see in your life. Well, to gain access to power, we must pray in faith. Yes. We must pray in Jesus' name. Yes. When I read this passage of Scripture, within my heart there bubbles up the words of an old hymn. Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens. Lord, with me abide. When other helpers fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, O abide with me. Swift to its close ebbs out life's little day. Earth's joys grow dim, its glories pass away. Change and decay, and all around I see. O thou who changest not, abide with me. I need thy presence every passing hour. What but thy grace can foil the tempter's power? Who like thyself my guide and stay can be through cloud and sunshine? O abide with me. Hold thou thy cross before my closing eyes. Shine through the gloom and point me to the skies. Heaven's morning breaks and earth's vain shadows flee. In life, in death, O Lord, abide with me. Our Father, I pray you shall bless the remarks that have been made from this pulpit this morning. In your word, you have taught us that you have exalted your word above your name. And today I trust that I have exalted both your word and your name. And I pray, Lord, that people will hear and respond. Like Saul on the Damascus Road, I pray that they will hear and heed. Be convicted, be changed, and be challenged to do your work. Speak to those here in the auditorium. Speak to those uncounted numbers watching online, and grant, O God, that someone may come to Jesus praying, I am a sinner, come into my heart, forgive me, save me, assure me that I'm going to heaven. And I pray, Lord, that someone here who's not a member of our church, guided by your Holy Spirit, shall come during the invitation moment to say, I'm a Christian, I want to join this church. God bless the invitation. May your name be glorified through our response, not only here at this moment, but through our response during the week ahead. In the saving name of Jesus, amen. Will you stand as we sing hymn 305, I've Decided to Follow Jesus, and I'll be here in the front. Come and take my hand and say, I'll receive Jesus. One of our counselors will come and explain to you the way of eternal life more fully. Come take my hand and say, I'm a Christian. I want to join this church. Again, one of our counselors will come and explain to you how you as a believer can become part of the fellowship of our congregation. 305, while we sing, I've Decided to Follow Jesus, I'll meet you here in the front.